Chapter 4. The Education of a Philosopher. The installation of the adopted stable boy was thus happily effected, and the wheels of life continued to run smoothly in the doctor's house. Jean-Marie did his horse and carriage duty in the morning, sometimes helped in the housework, sometimes walked abroad with the doctor, to drink wisdom from the fountainhead, and was introduced at night to the sciences and the dead tongues. He retained his singular placidity of mind and manner, he was rarely in fault, but he made only a very partial progress in his studies, and remained much of a stranger in the family. The doctor was a pattern of regularity. All forenoon he worked on his great book, the Comparative Pharmacopoeia, or Historical Dictionary of All Medicines, which as yet consisted principally of slips of paper and pins. When finished, it was to fill many personable volumes, and to combine antiquarian interest with professional utility. But the doctor was studious of literary graces and the picturesque, an anecdote, a touch of manners, a moral qualification, or a sounding epithet was sure to be preferred before a piece of science, a little more, and he would have written the Comparative Pharmacopoeia in verse. The article Mummia, for instance, was already complete, though the remainder of the work had not progressed beyond the letter A. It was exceedingly copious and entertaining, written with quaintness and color, exact, erudite, a literary article, but it would hardly have afforded guidance to a practicing physician of today. The feminine good sense of his wife had led her to point this out with uncompromising sincerity, for the dictionary was duly read aloud to her, betwixt sleep and waning, as it proceeded towards an infinitely distant completion. And the doctor was a little sore on the subject of mummies, and sometimes resented an allusion with asperity. After the midday meal and a proper period of digestion, he walked, sometimes alone, sometimes accompanied by Jean-Marie, for Madame would have preferred any hardship rather than walk. She was, as I have said, a very busy person, continually occupied about material comforts, and ready to drop asleep over a novel the instant she was disengaged. This was the less objectionable, as she never snored or grew distempered in complexion when she slept. On the contrary, she looked the very picture of luxurious and appetizing ease, and woke without a start to the perfect possession of her faculties. I am afraid she was greatly an animal, but she was a very nice animal to have about. In this way, she had little to do with Jean-Marie, but the sympathy which had been established between them on the first night remained unbroken. They held occasional conversations, mostly on household matters, to the extreme disappointment of the doctor. They occasionally sallied off together to that temple of debasing superstition, the village church. Madame and he, both in their Sunday's best, drove twice a month to Fontainebleau and returned laden with purchases. And in short, although the doctor still continued to regard them as irreconcilably antipathetic, their relation was as intimate, friendly, and confidential as their natures suffered. I fear, however, that in her heart of hearts, Madame kindly despised and pitied the boy. She had no admiration for his class of virtues. She liked a smart, polite, forward, roguish sort of boy, cap in hand, light of foot, meeting the eye. She liked volubility, charm, a little vice, the promise of a second Dr. Desprez. And it was her indefeasible belief that Jean-Marie was dull. Poor dear boy, she had said once, how sad it is that he should be so stupid. She had never repeated that remark, for the doctor had raged like a wild bull, denouncing the brutal bluntness of her mind, bemoaning his own fate to be so unequally mated with an ass, and, what touched Anastasia more nearly, menacing the table china by the fury of his gesticulations. But she adhered silently to her opinion, and when Jean-Marie was sitting, stolid, blank, but not unhappy, over his unfinished tasks, she would snatch her opportunity in the doctor's absence, go over to him, put her arms about his neck, lay her cheek to his, and communicate her sympathy with his distress. "Do not mind," she would say. "I, too, am not at all clever, and I can assure you that it makes no difference in life." The doctor's view was naturally different. That gentleman never wearied of the sound of his own voice, which was, to say the truth, agreeable enough to hear. He now had a listener, who was not so cynically indifferent as Anastasia, and who sometimes put him on his mettle by the most relevant objections. Besides, was he not educating the boy? And education, philosophers are agreed, is the most philosophical of duties. What can be more heavenly to poor mankind than to have one's hobby grow into a duty to the state? Then, indeed, do the ways of life become ways of pleasantness. Never had the doctor seen reason to be more content with his endowments. Philosophy flowed smoothly from his lips. He was so agile a dialectician that he could trace his nonsense, when challenged, back to some root in sense, and prove it to be a sort of flower upon his system. He slipped out of antinomies like a fish, and left his disciple marveling at the rabbi's depth. Moreover, deep down in his heart the doctor was disappointed with the ill success of his more formal education. A boy, chosen by so acute an observer for his aptitude, and guided along the path of learning by so philosophic an instructor, was bound, by the nature of the universe, to make a more obvious and lasting advance. Now Jean Marie was slow in all things, impenetrable in others, and his power of forgetting was fully on a level with his power to learn. Therefore the doctor cherished his peripatetic lectures, to which the boy attended, which he generally appeared to enjoy, and by which he often profited. Many and many were the talks they had together, and health and moderation proved the subject of the doctor's divagations. To these he lovingly returned. "I lead you," he would say, "by the green pastures. My system, my beliefs, my medicines, are resumed in one phrase to avoid excess. Blessed nature, healthy, temperate nature, abhors and exterminates excess. Human law, in this matter, imitates at a great distance her provisions, and we must strive to supplement the efforts of the law. Yes, boy, we must be a law to ourselves and for ourselves and for our neighbors, lexameter armed, emphatic, tyrannous law. If you see a crapulous human ruin snuffing, dash from him his box. The judge, though in a way an admission of disease, is less offensive to me than either the doctor or the priest. Above all the doctor and the purulent trash and garbage of his pharmacopoeia. Pure air from the neighborhood of Opintum for the sake of the turpentine unadulterated wine, and the reflections of an unsophisticated spirit in the presence of the works of nature, these, my boy, are the best medical appliances and the best religious comforts. Devote yourself to these. Hark! There are the bells of Buron, the wind is in the north, it will be fair. How clear and airy is the sound! The nerves are harmonized and quieted, the mind attuned to silence, and observe how easily and regularly beats the heart. Your unenlightened doctor would see nothing in these sensations, and yet you yourself perceive they are a part of health. Did you remember your cinchona this morning? Good. Cinchona also is a work of nature. It is, after all, only the bark of a tree which we might gather for ourselves if we lived in the locality. What a world is this! Though a professed atheist, I delight to bear my testimony to the world. Look at the gratuitous remedies and pleasures that surround our path. The river runs by the garden end, our bath, our fish pond, our natural system of drainage. There is a well in the court which sends up sparkling water from the earth's very heart, clean, cool, and, with a little wine, most wholesome. The district is notorious for its salubrity. Rheumatism is the only prevalent complaint, and I myself have never had a touch of it. I tell you, and my opinion is based upon the coldest, clearest processes of reason, if you, desired to leave this home of pleasures, it would be the duty, it would be the privilege, of our best friend to prevent us with a pistol bullet. One beautiful June day they sat upon the hill outside the village. The river, as blue as heaven, shone here and there among the foliage. The indefatigable birds turned and flickered about Gret's church tower. A healthy wind blew from over the forest, and the sound of innumerable thousands of treetops and innumerable millions on millions of green leaves was abroad in the air, and filled the ear with something between whispered speech and singing. It seemed as if every blade of grass must hide a sigh, and the fields rang merrily with their music, jingling far and near as with the sleigh bells of the Fairy Queen. From their station on the slope, the eye embraced a large space of poplared plain upon the one hand, the waving hilltops of the forest on the other, and Gretz itself in the middle, a handful of roofs. Under the bestriding arch of the blue heavens, the place seemed dwindled to a toy. It seemed incredible that people dwelt, and could find room to turn or air to breathe, in such a corner of the world. The thought came home to the boy, perhaps for the first time, and he gave it words. "How small it looks," he sighed. "Eh," replied the doctor, "small enough now. Yet it was once a walled city, thriving, full of furbjesses and men in armor, humming with affairs semicolon with tall spires, fraught that I know, and portly towers along the battlements. A thousand chimneys ceased smoking at the curfew bell. There were gibbets at the gate as thick as scarecrows. In time of war, the assault swarmed against it with ladders, the arrows fell like leaves, the defenders sallied hotly over the drawbridge, each side uttered its cry as they plied their weapons. Do you know that the walls extended as far as the commandery? Tradition so reports. Alas, what a long way off is all this confusion! Nothing left of it but my quiet words spoken in your ear, and the town itself shrunk to the hamlet underneath us. By and by came the English wars. You shall hear more of the English, a stupid people, who sometimes blundered into good, and Gretz was taken, sacked, and burned. It is the history of many towns. But Gretz never rose again, it was never rebuilt, its ruins were a quarry to serve the growth of rivals, and the stones of Gretz are now erect along the streets of Nems. It gratifies me that our old house was the first to rise after the calamity. When the town had come to an end, it inaugurated the hamlet. I, too, am glad of that, said Jean Marie. It should be the temple of the humbler virtues, responded the doctor with a savory gusto. Perhaps one of the reasons why I love my little hamlet as I do, is that we have a similar history, she and I. Have I told you that I was once rich? I do not think so, answered Jean Marie. I do not think I should have forgotten. I am sorry you should have lost your fortune. Sorry? Cried the doctor. Why, I find I have scarce begun your education after all. Listen to me. Would you rather live in the old Gretz or in the new, free from the alarms of war, with the green country at the door, without noise, passports, the exactions of the soldiery, or the jangle of the curfew bell to send us off to bed by sundown? I suppose I should prefer the new, replied the boy. Precisely, returned the doctor, so do I. And, in the same way, I prefer my present moderate fortune to my former wealth. Golden mediocrity! Cried the adorable ancients, and I subscribe to their enthusiasm. Have I not good wine, good food, good air, the fields and the forest for my walk, a house, an admirable wife, a boy whom I protest I cherish like a son? Now, if I were still rich, I should indubitably make my residence in Paris. You know Paris. Paris and paradise are not convertible terms. This pleasant noise of the wind streaming among leaves changed into the grinding babble of the street, the stupid glare of plaster substituted for this quiet pattern of greens and greys, the nerves shattered, the digestion falsified, picture the fall. Already you perceive the consequences. The mind is stimulated, the heart steps to a different measure, and the man is himself no longer. I have passionately studied myself the true business of philosophy. I know my character as the musician knows the vintages of his flute. Should I return to Paris, I should ruin myself gambling. Nay, I go further, I should break the heart of my Anastasie with infidelities. This was too much for Jean Marie. That a place should so transform the most excellent of men transcended his belief. Paris, he protested, was even an agreeable place of residence. Nor when I lived in that city did I feel much difference,